Well, good morning. Welcome to Cornerstone. We're glad that you're with us this morning. Please stand and join us.
Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. Wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. Wait upon the Lord. We will wait.
Jesus, we come to you this morning, Lord, and we are thankful, God, and we are just thankful for this place that you have given us where we can come and worship you, Lord. We are thankful, Lord, for the creation that you have given us. And God, we just pray that today that you would use this service, Lord, that you would just speak through Pastor John, that you would work through our hearts, Lord, change us and make us what you want us to be. We love you, Jesus, and we pray in your name. Amen.
Your majesty, you are holy, holy, Because of me.
God, there is no one more beautiful. You are beautiful, God, you are the most beautiful.
Continue this morning our series called Triumph. You can turn in your Bibles into Acts chapter 2. And we started this 2 weeks ago where we began this on the triumph that we have through Christ over the grave. Triumph over the grave, over sin. And we discussed that on Resurrection Sunday, Easter Sunday. From there, we talked about triumph in the church, that our church is not merely supposed to survive in these dark times, but to thrive. And that one of the marks, as we talked about the marks of a healthy church, a growing church, a thriving church, a church that is advancing the kingdom of God, one of those marks was joy. And I actually gave you a homework assignment, so I'm sure you all did that very well. Remember, we were focusing on the source of our joy and not focusing on those things that steal and take away from our joy, right? And right off the gates, you had to face a Monday. So we saw how committed you were to that throughout the rest of the week. So I hope that went well for you. Another thing that we saw was a mark of that church is one that was filled with the Spirit. The presence of the Spirit, the empowerment of the Spirit was there. In fact, I'm going to just kind of read where we were in Luke 24, where Jesus said, "Behold, I am sending the promise of my Father upon you, but stay in the city until you are clothed with power from on high." Now, that was the instruction that Luke recorded from Jesus to the disciples. Stay where you're at until you receive power from on high. Well, Luke also wrote the book of Acts, and where he left off in the book of Luke is right where he begins in the book of Acts. And if you're there now, you might notice just a page before in chapter 1, verse 8, this is the theme verse of the book of Acts, and it says this: "But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and all Judea and Samaria to the end of the earth," to the point that you and I are here this morning worshiping Jesus. I mean, this worked. 2,000 years later, on the other side of the globe, here we are because of the power that came that birthed the church. Now, what you're going to find as we go through Acts chapter 2 is that the Holy Spirit plays a central role in the church and in the life of the believer. Okay, so we're going to focus on that. We're going to watch how many times he's mentioned, what he does, and what it is that we are supposed to do to respond to that. How do we incorporate this into our lives? Now, I hope you'll enjoy this because in Acts chapter 2, the birth of the church was wild. It was crazy. There was all kinds of stuff going on as the Holy Spirit came down as was promised, and he manifests himself. And it's just a really neat recording here of what all happened when that moment in time took place that the Holy Spirit came and birthed the church. So Acts chapter 2, let's get into this. And we won't get far before I have to do a little bit of explaining. When the day of Pentecost arrived, let's talk about Pentecost real quick. Pentecost is a Greek name for that season, that festival. The Jews called it the Feast of Harvest or the Feast of Weeks. It came in line with the wheat harvest before the barley harvest, and it was a time of celebration. It was also a pilgriming festival, which meant that Jews from all over the area and region, from even far away, would come in to celebrate this in Jerusalem. So this will help explain why we have the scene that we do. We have people from all kinds of different cities and tongues and languages coming to one place, and it is a Jewish holiday, a festival. In fact, if I could describe it, probably the closest thing we have in America would be something like Mardi Gras. I mean, this was a time that people just let loose, and it could get pretty crazy. In fact, you're going to see that one of the assumptions right off the bat, before we even got to lunchtime in this story, is that people just assumed everybody's drunk. That's the kind of celebration we have going on here. It could be a wild holiday. So we have the day of Pentecost arriving, and they were all together in one place. They were talking about the disciples. We're all together. They're doing what they've been told to do. They're waiting for power to come on high. They're just staying put until whatever's supposed to happen happens. And it must have been an interesting time as they're discussing together, well, what is this going to look like? How will we know when the power comes from on high? Well, turns out you couldn't really miss it when it happened, because listen to this. Suddenly, there came from heaven a sound like a mighty rushing wind, and it filled the entire house where they were sitting. and divided tongues as of fire appeared to them and rested on each one of them. And they were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other languages, other tongues, as the Spirit gave them utterance. All right. Well, that was a little out of the ordinary. They're sitting here all gathered into one place. All of a sudden, a mighty rushing wind overtakes the room that they're in. I mean, it's not like, hey, did someone leave a window open kind of rushing wind. They're looking at each other wide-eyed. What is going on? Extremely loud winds coming through. And then divided tongues as of fire. I'm not really sure what that looked like, but they're trying to explain it to us. Appeared to them and rested over each one of them. So the Holy Spirit, as He comes with power to fill them, He manifests Himself both audio and video. Okay? We were seeing this, we're hearing this, we're thinking, wow, this is an amazing experience. And the result was they were filled with the Holy Spirit. Now, that's what they were commanded to wait for. Jesus said, I must ascend so that the Comforter may come, so that you can receive power from on high. So He comes down and He fulfills His purpose in such a way. The purpose was that they would be filled with the Spirit, empowered by the Spirit. But He does so in such a way that there's no question, this is what Jesus was talking about. Okay? And by the way, this is not prescriptive. This is not what should happen to every Christian today who is filled with the Spirit. All right, this was the birth of the church and the way that the Spirit was marking this, saying, here I'm coming. Know that I am here. This is what happened to them. And they began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterances. And as you'll see from this chapter, these were known languages. And that's going to play a crucial role as we have people from all different areas coming together where the gospel is going to be proclaimed. So again, this is not setting forth the standard of Christian experience, what should be normative for Christians as they're filled with the Holy Spirit today. But this was the birth of the church, and it was done in such a powerful way so that there would be no question, this is what Jesus talked about when He said that we were supposed to wait for power to come from on high. So in Acts 1:8, we talked about that power coming when the Holy Spirit has come upon them. Now in Acts chapter 2, verse 4, we see that they are indeed filled with the Holy Spirit. So you're going to see the Holy Spirit in every key element of this account where the church was born. Let's continue the narrative in verse 5. Now there were dwelling in Jerusalem Jews, devout men from every nation under heaven. And at the sound, the multitude came together. Okay, the multitude heard this. There's something weird going on over here. And they were bewildered because each one was hearing them speak in his own language. Just as we said, they were speaking languages that were understood by others. And they were not their own tongue. And they were amazed and astonished, saying, are not all these who are speaking Galileans? That's the nice way of saying Galileans are not known for their academia and multiple languages. And that these guys are fishermen. What are they doing speaking fluent languages? This does not fit a Galilean Jew. And how is it that we hear each of us in his own native language? This is mind-boggling. This doesn't make sense. Yet you ever have one of those experiences in your life where you just can't figure out what happened? It was beyond explanation. You're sitting there racking your brain. What in the world is going on here? Well, they were having one of those experiences. What's happening in front of us makes no sense. What's this wind sound? How come Galilean fishermen are speaking fluent languages and we are hearing them in our own languages? And by the way, there's 11 disciples and they list 15 different regions and peoples that were in this place, all hearing their own native tongue. And they're saying, man, this is beyond explanation. What's happening here? Verse 11, we hear them telling in our own tongues the mighty works of God. Okay, now understand, again, remember, when the Holy Spirit manifests Himself, He always has the intention of magnifying Christ. Always, always, always. Some churches get off base sometimes when we start to seek the manifestations of the Spirit rather than to be led by the Spirit to the exaltation of Christ in whatever form he does that. So can the Spirit work in magnificent different ways all around the world today? He sure can. But whatever he's doing, if it's signs and wonders or whatever, it's not for the purpose for us to say, wow, look how cool this is that this is happening. No, it is to make a point here to say, this is happening in a supernatural way, and it will point to Christ. It will exalt Christ, or it will become extremely unhealthy, like what happened to the church in Corinth, where Paul has to come in and say, guys, you're way off base. You've lost your focus on Christ, which is what the Spirit is trying to do here. So they are hearing in their own tongues the mighty works of God. That's what's coming out of the disciples' mouths. Verse 12, and they were amazed and perplexed, saying to one another, what does this mean? All right, that's their way of saying, what is going on here? What is this about? But others mocking said, they are filled with new wine. So you have people in the crowd saying two different things. Number one, some are recognizing, look, I'm putting all this together and it ain't making any sense. And whatever's happening is legit. I'm hearing fluently my own language by Galilean fishermen. That can't happen. And not only that, my friends beside me are hearing in their own native tongue. What's happening here? Why was it preceded by this giant rushing wind? What is happening? And then others are seeing this, and rather than trying to put it together, rather than trying to deal with it mentally, they're saying, man, these guys got into the wine good and early. All right, they found it, and they found it fast, and we're just here to have a good time with them, and we're going to laugh this off. They're not going to try to connect the dots. They're not even going to make an attempt. They just mocked. So some were perplexed and amazed. Others mocked. Let's continue in verse 14, because now the disciples are going to make a stand. But Peter, standing with the 11, this is Peter who ran away and abandoned Jesus right before the crucifixion. This is Peter who denied Jesus three times so that there would be no association because he was scared to death. That this is the Peter that messed up in every way possible when Jesus was crucified. Now filled with the Spirit, he stands up at Pentecost, again, like a Mardi Gras, like this is not the place for preaching, okay? Well, Peter doesn't care. He stands up, filled with the Spirit, lifts his voice, and addresses the crowd. Men of Judea and all who dwell in Jerusalem, let this be known to you and give ear to my words. He commands their attention. I'm going to explain what's going on here. For these people are not drunk as you suppose, since it is only the third hour of the day. Translation, it's not even lunchtime, guys. We're not drunk. That's not what's happening. And then Peter begins to explain by using a quote from one of the minor prophets, Joel, that the Jews were very familiar with. In verse 16, he says, what is happening now is what was uttered from the lips of Joel. Listen. Verse 17, in the last days it shall be, God declares, that I will pour out my Spirit on all flesh. Again, the central role in all of this is the Spirit of God. And the Spirit of God has come. He said, Joel prophesied this. His Spirit is coming, just like he said. And there's different manifestations. Your sons and your daughters shall prophesy. Your young men shall see visions. Your old men shall dream dreams. Even on my male servants and female servants in those days, here it is again, I will pour out my Spirit, and they will prophesy. And I will show wonders in the heavens above and signs in the earth below, blood and fire and vapor of smoke. The sun shall be turned to darkness, the moon to blood. Church, these are signs that are raising eyebrows today. I mean, this is more relevant to us than it was to those who Peter was preaching to. Before the day of the Lord comes, the great and magnificent day, and it shall come to pass that everyone who calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. So Peter says this to all these people who are listening, who are scratching their heads, what's going on here? He says, this is what Joel prophesied. The Spirit of the Lord has come upon us. That's what you are seeing. And we are entering into the last days now where the manifestations of the Spirit are going to come in different ways. And as you will watch this, you're going to understand that the day of the Lord is approaching, and whoever calls upon the name of the Lord during this time will be saved. So Peter's putting all this together for him. You need to know, people, what's happening here, because it's your time to respond. So as he gives the scripture that connects directly to this event, it was prophesied, now he begins the preaching. He just read from the Word of God. Now he's going to preach in verse 22. Men of Israel, hear these words. Second time he's addressed the crowd. Listen up. Listen to this. Jesus of Nazareth, a man attested to you by God with mighty works and wonders and signs that God did through him in your midst, as you yourselves know, this Jesus, delivered up according to the definite plan and foreknowledge of God, you crucified and killed by the hands of lawless men. So Peter lays it right on the line. You are the guys who took the Messiah that we have been waiting for thousands of years, and you nailed him to a cross, you chanted, crucified him, and now he's dead. But verse 24 didn't end there. God raised him up, loosing the pangs of death, because it was not possible for him to be held by it. Peter's a good preacher. I like the way he put that. Death could not hold him down. You killed him. He came back. And we were witnesses of this. So Peter is challenging them directly. You are the people who did this. And I'm not going to read all of this. He goes into another passage. It's a reference, a prophetic reference, a messianic passage from Psalms by King David. And he kind of goes through that, connecting the dots for them that Jesus is the King and the Lord that David looked forward to, that he prophesied about in the Psalms. I'm going to skip down to verse 32. This Jesus God raised up, and of that we are witnesses. So the disciples are standing up before this crowd that crucified Jesus and said, we are here to tell you that the man you killed was our Messiah, and we are witnesses that he was raised again to life. Being therefore exalted at the right hand of God, because remember, right now, Peter's filled with the Spirit, right? His words are going out with power. The Word of God is going out with power. And look what words he uses. He's exalted at the right hand of God because the Spirit exalts Christ. And having received from the Father the promise of the Holy Spirit, he has poured out this that you yourselves are seeing and hearing. Right now, you are seeing the Spirit of God poured out as God promised. So again, here's the Holy Spirit mentioned over and over and over at the birth of the church. The Spirit played the key role. Let me jump down to verse 36. He continues his preaching. Let all the house of Israel therefore know for certain that God has made him both Lord and Christ, this Jesus whom you crucified. And I'm going to stop right there. You know, one note that I took in here is that if you're a seeker-sensitive church, you probably don't want to have Peter be your guest speaker, because this is like the most unseeker-friendly sermon I have ever read. You're the guys that crucified Jesus. You crucified our Messiah. You did it. And they're all just taking this in. And it's not hitting on empty hearts, because what happens when the Spirit gets involved? The Word of God goes out with power, and receptive hearts begin to hear. The Spirit is on both sides of the equation. The Spirit started this by empowering the disciples. He moved Peter to be bold and speak truth. He empowered the words so that the ears of the people who are hearing would be moved. Their hearts are pierced. He's bringing conviction. Look at the Holy Spirit just saturating this thing. None of this would be happening without the Holy Spirit. Peter would have never even stood up. He'd have been too scared. Nothing would have happened. It would have been another harvest of weeks, just like normal. But the Spirit showed up. Now, verse 37. When they heard this, they were cut to the heart and said to Peter and the rest of the apostles, brothers, what shall we do? I love that. Man, God gets so excited when His Word hits somebody's heart and they simply say, what do I do? Okay, I'm feeling the conviction of the Spirit. What do I do? Well, Peter's more than happy to answer the question. Repent and be baptized. Repent. Stop living in sin. Acknowledge what you did to our Messiah. Acknowledge that you are a sinner and stop living for that, but turn to God. Turn from yourselves. Repent and then be baptized. Publicly confess Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. Every one of you in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins, and you too will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. Now, this part is nominative. This part is predictive. This is part of the plan. When you get saved, when your sins are forgiven, you too receive the power from on high. The Holy Spirit takes residence in you. And then it is simply a matter of how much of the Holy Spirit gets to rule in your life. How much are you going to submit to Him, and how much are you going to suppress Him? Because the design is that He would have full reign and authority in your life as a new believer. Nothing held back. That's the design. And the more we submit to that, the more our lives are going to reflect the awesome boldness of this disciple that we know in the flesh is already a coward. The Spirit changed everything. The Spirit made Peter new. Not the old Peter. That's not the Peter I read about in the Gospels. This is a completely different guy because he's filled with the Spirit. Let me challenge you, church. One thing that the Spirit's going to do, if He fills you and you are surrendered and sold out to that, you with your life, with your actions, with your thoughts, your decisions, your heart, and your mouth are going to exalt Christ. You're going to do that. And if you are not filled with the Spirit, you're not going to. So it comes down to this. Let me just push you just a little bit, okay? If you've been a Christian for a period of time, maybe a few years, maybe a decade or more, and you have never got to the point where you can share your faith and take that step of faith where you're telling someone about Christ, what He's done for them, the forgiveness of sins, and how they can find salvation in Jesus Christ, I can tell you the primary symptom is you're living in the power of the flesh. Your flesh won't let you do that. There's just no way it's going to happen. But if you allow yourself to be filled with the Spirit, to the point where you are surrendered in every area, the Spirit is going to rise up in you and say, I'm going to exalt Christ with this life because it's what I do. It's what I've come to do. And if we are surrendered to that, we will see this manifestation of power in our lives. That's why the Bible tells us, don't quench the Spirit. Don't put Him out. Don't try to reign over Him. Allow Him to reign over you. Submit to that. And you will find a boldness that you did not know that you possessed. It's the Spirit's boldness. You'll be amazed what can happen in your life when you let the Spirit reign. But letting the Spirit reign is terrifying. Right? If you're anything like me, I like to be in control. I love controlling things so that I know how it's going to happen and how it's going to end. When you let go of all of that when the Holy Spirit takes control. And you just say, Spirit, today is your day. This is your life to do as you will. You give opportunity, you will find me obedient. My answer is already yes to whatever your command is going to be. Live in this way, and you will find that you have a boldness to exalt Christ like never before. But hold on to the flesh, church. Don't surrender that area in your life that you're coddling and keeping secret, or whatever it is. As we hold on to sin, we are not going to be filled with the Spirit. It is a one or the other. Either sin is ruling and reigning in your life or the Spirit is. You can't have both. Some of us are very good at convincing ourselves that we can have both. But you'll notice if you've hung on to sin for a long time, this manifestation of power, a conquering sin in the flesh, being a bold witness for Christ, exalting Christ privately and publicly, that's gone when you're holding on to sin. Because it's the one who is controlling you. It's the one who you are surrendered to. And no exaltation of Christ will come from sin. None whatsoever. So here we see that the gift of the Holy Spirit is promised to the very people who crucified Christ. Not only will God forgive you of your sins, He will fill you with His Spirit so that you will become a proclaimer of Christ. Well, this is pretty interesting stuff. So let's skip down to verse 41. So those who received His word were baptized, and there were added that day about 3,000 souls. The people were responsive. In whatever form it looked like, they were storming the altar. There's no altar here because they're not in church, but they're having church, aren't they? and people are surrendering to the call of the Spirit, and they're being convicted of their sins. They're shouting from the crowd, "What must we do?" Peter's telling them, you've got to repent and be baptized, and they're responding, and they're being baptized right there. This is an amazing outpouring of the Spirit, and it is the birth of the church. Do you realize that the very people who crucified Jesus made the first church? Now, that's a pretty powerful witness. And these people were sold out. Before I go any further, I want to just point out a couple things that I really appreciate about Peter's preaching. And of course, his preaching is under the influence of the Holy Spirit. So number one, in this passage, we see God meeting these people right where they are at. Okay, so let's just take a little break here. I want you to think with me. Can you go back to that place where God found you, where He gripped you, where He changed you? And this will look really different for each of us. I remember in my life, I was 19 when the roots went real deep. Now, I had a salvation experience when I was, I don't know, 5 or 6. I was really, really young. And I heard about Jesus, and I heard the teaching of the Bible, and I responded to that. I believed that I was a sinner and that I was in need of a Savior, and I happily accepted Christ into my life. But really, quite honestly, it was more of my parents' faith. I had watched it demonstrated. It's all that I knew. Did I love the Lord for real? Yeah, I really did. But it had, my faith hadn't been tested yet for me. That point came when I was 19. You know, and the point comes all differently for each of us. It's going to be a time when maybe a teacher is pushing back against your worldview, that your peers are pushing back on your beliefs and the way that you live. And there's going to be a time when your faith has to take deep root right where you're at. And you own it as your own faith. This isn't your parents' faith. This isn't your church's faith. It's yours now. You're putting a stake in the ground and you're holding it against the pressure. It's becoming yours now. The roots are going deep. For me, that was 19. I was in college. And here's what I want to point out. When God meets us where we're at, it's usually not pretty. Okay? I was not living my best at 19. And I'm not going to go into all the details, but that would have probably been, in my guess now looking back, the last place that God would have come and grabbed my heart and started to really deal with me. See, we are fed this line, and I'm not sure where it comes from. We come up with it ourselves, or our enemy kind of whispers it in our ear, but we get this mindset that I've got to clean my life up first before I come to God. Man, that's absolute baloney. It really is. I was the messiest that I could have possibly been in my life when God grabbed me. And He was okay with that. He came after me right in that moment around all my sin and all my rebellion. I was doing things I knew better. And He came down in the middle of that mess. And He said, "John, I love you. And this ain't what I created you for. And you know that you're living wrong. What are we going to do? What's it going to be?" Man, I lost all my peace. God, what'd you do that for? It took all the fun out of everything. And my heart began to long for God as He called my name. And I had to make a decision. I knew that God was not calling me to just make a little move forward or just forget this one area. He wanted everything surrendered. It was 100% or it was nothing. And He made that very clear in my heart. And it took me about 6 months of wrestling before I finally surrendered that. And I didn't clean up my life first. It was a moment in the middle of my mess when I said, "Lord, okay, I'm done. I can't do this. I can't fight with you anymore. I want to live for you. I want my peace back. I want that relationship that I enjoyed as a child. This is becoming my faith. I choose to live for you." And in that moment, God changed me from the inside out, and things began to just fall off my plate. The sins that were in my life began to fall away, and my love became Christ instead of the pleasures of this world. Now, for some of you in here this morning, you're on one side or the other. You might be thinking, "Yeah, I remember that time in my life," and you're kind of snickering right now. You're smiling. I can see it in your face. It brings us joy when we think back to that point where God gripped us. And for others of you, You're thinking, you know, I don't really know what that looks like, and I'm not completely tracking with you, and maybe that's something that's yet to come for you. I do want to say this. If you're here this morning and you're hearing this, and it's kind of a foreign thing to you, you're not here by accident. That's part of how the Holy Hound of Heaven works. He hunts you down. He follows you. And however you're here, for whatever reason, whether you just chose to come here this morning or you've got a friend in here that's been asking you to come or whatever the issue is, I want you to know this. God is after you, and He loves you, and He wants you to be in His family. So you're experiencing much of what I went through and what many in here have gone through. I wish we had the time to maybe just pluck a few stories out and listen to them, because I think you'll find them very similar to mine. God doesn't wait till we're all cleaned up. That doesn't impress Him even a little bit. But He comes in the mess, and He delivers us, and then we give God the glory. So I appreciate that God meets us where we are at, rather than saying, I want you to come out here, clean yourself up, and then we'll talk. That's not how God works. Number two, God confronts us with truth. I tell you what, God is not gentle. When He had this conversation, when you watch this take place, as the Spirit is moving in Peter and He is speaking to this crowd, He's not saying, you know, what you did wasn't all that bad. It was a mistake, a misunderstanding. Surely God will understand. No, it was this Jesus whom you crucified. You crucified our Messiah. You did that. And He let them have it to the point where they were crying out, what do we do? Man, we have messed up. We are a broken people. How will God accept us now? God does that with us as well. The voice of God does not just quietly whisper in your ear, you're really okay. Everything's just fine. Relax. Okay? Here's what God says in Romans chapter 3. Very familiar verse 23, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. You are not okay. You fall short of God's expectations, and He's not bashful or gentle about that. You've rebelled against me. You've fallen short of my expectations. And the penalty is eternal damnation. It's a very serious penalty. I do want to point this out. I'm in this passage, for all of sin and fall short of the glory of God. That does remind us, Christians, that there's not a one of us in here better than anyone else. That is a level playing field. Okay? And how dare we, as Christians, look around and say, yeah, there's one. Oh, I can't imagine. I am so many levels above that. Thank God that I haven't stooped to that place in life. I tell you what, Christians, if it wasn't for the righteousness of Christ imparted to us, there's zero difference. None. And if we find ourselves looking down on others' sins, exalting ourselves, we're in a place where God's judgment on us is imminent. He will put us in our place. That is not for us to do. Our hearts are to break when we see our brothers and sisters struggling in sin. We have not been given the holy gavel of heaven to go around and hammering down on those who are struggling in sin. All right, we must adopt the attitude of Paul in Corinthians, who goes through all the lists of horrible sins and says, as were we. But God delivered us from that, and now we have the blessing of the righteousness of Christ. Let us never use the righteousness of Christ to look down at someone else and try to exalt ourselves. That will end badly for us. Churches die because of that. There's no honor in Christ with that kind of behavior. Verse 24, for all of sin fall short of the glory of God and are justified by His grace as a gift through the redemption that is Christ Jesus. Now again, this is all part of God just telling us straight that this is how it is. This is truth. You fall short. But it is Jesus who justifies us as a gift. Well, justification, the easiest way I can explain that for you, the best definition I've heard, just as if I never sinned. He wipes away every sin we've ever committed, and Jesus pays the penalty, taking it away so that we are literally righteous in heaven. We're declared legally. The gavel falls. You are righteous with the righteousness of Christ. This is part of the gift that God gives to us because we're not okay. We can't get out of this. And this is done through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus. A redemption is a payment. Someone's got to pay the price for the penalty of sin. Well, Jesus did that. In fact, 1 Corinthians 5:21 says that God made him who had no sin to be sin for us so that we might become the righteousness of God. That's mind-blowing. You and I are the righteousness of God because of what Jesus did, because of the redemption that we have. And then verse 25, it starts using really big words, whom God put forward as a propitiation by his blood to be received by faith. Propitiation is simply to satisfy the wrath by making the payment for the penalty. Okay, so that was done by Christ's blood according to the scriptures. Jesus satisfied God's wrath, which church is no joke. God sees rebellion against him and sin against him, and he is infuriated. He's the King of Kings. He's the Lord of Lords. He created the universe. How dare anything in this rebel against him? But we have. So the wrath is real. Jesus satisfies the wrath with his blood. Father, pour your wrath out on me. Let me take their place. And he does. So this is done by his blood to be received by faith. The whole transaction is made complete. We'll go back to the Joel's prophecy that whoever calls upon the name of the Lord will be saved. When we understand this, that we fall short of God's expectations, short of his glory, our sin has put us in a terrible spot, that we are not okay and we can't fix it, when we cry out to God for his gift, where Jesus has done all the work, and he offers to us his righteousness, which is the only righteousness that grants us access into heaven, it changes everything. That's the essence of the gospel. The gospel is freedom from our sin instead of enslavement to it. And this is what we are offered. And this is what's happening here in Acts chapter 2 as these people are responding to the gospel. But by the way, the gospel always demands a response. As you hear the gospel this morning, you will respond to it in one way or another. This has been said that the same sun that melts the ice hardens the clay. And what that means is the same gospel message that softens one heart to the reign of Christ in that life will harden another heart. But you're the one that makes the decision. You're going to go one way or the other. You know, and there's some people who have sat in church for years and they have learned how to harden their heart to the gospel message. And Sunday after Sunday after Sunday after Sunday, they are playing an extremely dangerous game. As they see the call of the gospel, they understand the call of the gospel, and they resist the call of the gospel, and their heart becomes just a little harder and harder, week after week after week. What a dangerous game you're playing. Because I don't know when it comes so hard that it's unbreakable. I do know this, that if God is wrestling in your heart this morning, it's not too late. But I have seen it too late. I have seen on a deathbed, as one pastor pleaded with a man who rejected God all his life as an atheist. And then on his deathbed, he believed. He believed that Jesus, he knew that it was real. And as he was phasing in and out of death, he was seeing things and he was terrified. And he said, I know it's real. And the pastor pled with him, then believe and be saved. And he just kept saying, it's too late. It's too late. I can't. His heart had been hardened to the point where he was out of chances. He was done. He entered into eternity knowing the truth, not submitting to it. We have to be careful, people. Maybe this morning you're hearing the gospel in a fresh way for the first time. You will respond to it. You will either take a step backwards in resistance, and as a result, your heart, you will leave here with a harder heart than you came here with. That's extremely dangerous. The more you do that, the easier it gets to harden your heart. The more likely your next response to the opportunity of the gospel will be to harden your heart. And there will be some of you who take a small step forward and begin the process of softening your heart, responding to the gospel. But you will do one of the two. The gospel demands a response. Finally, is the last part of this chapter, verse 42. See, when God does this, when God meets us where we're at, He exposes us to His truth, He presents us with the gospel, and we respond in a positive way, like these people who were cut to the heart, asked, "What shall we do?" Peter says, "Repent and be baptized," and they were. What does God do then? He places them in a church where they can grow. Listen to this. And they devoted themselves. This is the first church made up of all these people that just got saved. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to the fellowship. These people were a devoted people to the Word of God and to one another, to the breaking of bread and prayers. And all came upon every soul, and many wonders and signs were done through the apostles. And all who believed were together and had all things in common. And they were selling their possessions and belongings and distributing the proceeds to all as any had need. Verse 46, and day by day, attending the temple together and breaking bread in their homes, they received their food with glad and generous hearts. Let me just pause right here. A few things I see about this church, and we could spend a whole sermon real easy in that group of verses. But let me just kind of make the simple overview here. Number one, these people were a devoted people, devoted to the Scriptures and devoted to one another, so much so that they were selling off land, property, personal possessions and belongings to cover the needs of the others that were in this church. I mean, there was real devotion to one another. And remember, there was people here that had traveled from places far away. So there was Christians now that were establishing this church that were going to stay in Jerusalem with great need. They had forsaken it all. So this church comes together doing whatever it's going to take to build this first church. And they were devoted to one another. They were devoted to the teachings of the apostle, to the Word of God. And listen to this in verse 46. They received their food with glad and generous hearts. Two more marks of this early church. They were glad. Man, they were happy for what they had. They weren't worried about the next thing that they could own, the next thing they could work for, the next thing they could accumulate. They were giving that stuff away. They had just received the greatest gift of all, and they knew it. Physical belongings meant very little to them now, and that led to generosity. They had generous hearts. They weren't worried about what they deserved and what people owed them. They were selling and giving away. It was an incredible time for the church. They were praising God and having favor with all the people. And the Lord added to their number day by day those who were being saved. Once again, we see the Holy Spirit saturating this thing. He began by filling the disciples and then empowering them to be bold witnesses for Christ. Then He struck the hearts of the people, piercing them, convicting them for response. And then the Spirit built His first church right here in Jerusalem. And daily, people were being saved as they watched all this unfold. May we be a church like this that is so centered on the Holy Spirit and as a result are focused on exalting Christ that our church continues to grow day after day, week after week. That is not impossible. I've heard this preached in such disappointing ways. Like people can't be added to the church day by day anymore. That was way back then when the Spirit was doing something new and fresh and crazy. No, we live in a county with tens of thousands of people who are hungry and hurting without a Savior. It's completely feasible that day by day people could be coming to the church. The problem is that God's church isn't filled with the Spirit. And when that's happening, no, people aren't going to be saved day by day. But when we are filled with the Spirit, surrendered to the Lord, not hanging on sin, soft hearts, pressing into God, people are going to be saved all the time. All the time. It is not even a small stretch of the imagination that right here in Clarion County, people could be getting saved as we leave this church every single day, coming back, celebrating new births in Christ. That's not even a stretch. It really isn't. We've convinced ourselves that that's beyond the way that the Spirit operates today, but it absolutely is not. The Spirit is waiting for His church to wake up. He is the same Spirit today as He was back then. And the harvest is as ripe today as it was back then. There are more people now. But we have to be a people who are filled with the Spirit. And I don't have time in the last 5 minutes to start saying, okay, this is how you be filled with the Spirit. So I'm going to make it real, real simple. You're either surrendered to sin or you're surrendered to God. You surrender to God and the Spirit will increase in power daily for you. As you abide in Christ, you stay by Him, you hunger for the Word, and you surrender constantly, confessing your sins on a daily basis. As you identify them, you forsake them, you confess them, all in an effort to grow closer and closer to the Lord. The closer you grow, the more powerful the Spirit will manifest Himself in your life. The more of the Spirit that is manifesting in your life, the more your life will exalt Christ. It's that simple. You will demonstrate a boldness and a courage that you didn't know that you had, because it's not yours, it's the Spirit's. Or you will harbor sin in your life and completely quench the Spirit. And in harboring that Spirit, in harboring that sin, you will figure out how to live with a form of godliness that is devoid of power. As most of our churches across the nation today, we have learned to live that way as Christians. Look good on the outside, rotten away on the inside, zero power of the Spirit, but we come here in our Sunday best, we hear a message, we go home for another week of it. Until we surrender our lives and sin has no place, we will never experience the bold witness that these first disciples did. So even as Christians, we learn how to harden the heart or how to soften it. If you're abiding in Christ, if approaching God daily, tenderly, hungering for His righteousness, seeking Him through the Word, surrendering in your heart of hearts, saying, Lord, if there's any way in me that doesn't line up, let's fix it now. I desire to stay and remain in You. As we do that day after day, Christians, you're going to be filled with the Spirit. You're going to have a joy in you and a power in you and a boldness in you and an excitement in you that you want to exalt Christ with your life, and you will be amazed at the Spirit and the ways that He will direct you to people who are ripe for the gospel. He's in control of this stuff, remember? And He will direct lost people to obedient servants and connect them. But it's Jesus whose heart breaks and says, man, I've got all these lost people, and where are my obedient servants? Where are my laborers? They're so few. I can't make the connections fast enough. Cornerstone, may we be a church who takes this seriously, who are filled with the Spirit, experience the joy, the triumph in the Christian life, and who has a heart that is soft to God as we press into Him, rather than these hearts that are hid from God, and we avoid Him, we resist Him, and we just play the game with no power. Man, the Holy Spirit is the key to the growing church and the victorious Christian life. We don't run from Him. We're not afraid of Him. We make sure that we are aligning with His priorities. We don't go chasing after signs and wonders. We chase after Christ. We keep our eyes fixed on Christ, and the Holy Spirit will honor that. We must be a people who are filled with the Spirit. So let me ask you, church, look at your last week or your last year, whatever you want to examine. Are you filled with the Spirit? And if you're not, do you notice in your own heart, have you learned how to harden your heart a little bit so this doesn't bother you? Let's break that just a little bit this morning with a change in the cycle where we come to church, we resist the Spirit. We still receive a blessing from being around God's people. We receive a blessing from God's Word, but we don't leave with any power. Break the cycle this morning by taking a step in the other direction, opening the wall just a little bit more and saying, God, Your design is what I want. Being filled with the Spirit, that's what I want. Would You help me find victory over the sin in my life? Some of us have been harboring that sin for maybe even decades. It's crazy how long that can happen. And how does it happen? Because we harden our hearts, and then the conviction doesn't hit so hard, and we're just able to go through the motions. Boy, Christians, if that's you this morning, let's take a step in the other direction and just say, Lord, I'm tender in my heart this morning. I'm softening it, and I'm pressing into You a little bit. work with me because this is an area I struggle in, but I don't want my life to quench the Spirit anymore. I don't want that to be me. Boy, God's so tender to that prayer because he wants that for you. Church, I think we understand the call of God this morning. Let's bow our heads and close our eyes. And as you are preparing to pray, right now in your heart of hearts, as you're thinking where you need to respond this morning, let me ask you this. Is Christ your Lord and Savior? Have you confessed your sin to God? Have you asked that Jesus come and reside in you as Lord and Savior? Have you had that conversation with God? Are you confident that he is your king, that if you were to die today, you would go into his presence for all eternity? Let me remind you, just as we're examining our hearts, you've got the choice because you've heard the gospel clearly this morning. God desires to begin a relationship with you. How will you respond? Will you soften your heart and press into the Lord? Or are you going to take a step backwards this morning and begin that ugly process, that dangerous process of hardening your heart? Not now, Lord. Not this week. Another time. Please don't tell him that. Do not harden your hearts. In this moment right now, no one looking around, every head is bowed, every eye closed. Would you take that small step forward? Don't be ashamed, no reason to be embarrassed. But would you take that small step forward just by putting your hand up in the air for me to see? That's your way of acknowledging, God, I'm not moving backwards here this morning. I want to take a step into you, a step towards you. Right now, would you just put your hand up into the air for me to see? Maybe you've been coming to church for a long time and you've heard the gospel message so many times and you recognize you don't personally own this. You just know of this. You've never had that time where your own roots sink down like when I was 19. And you've just gotten really good at hardening your heart during this time right now. Would you just change that up this morning? I don't know how many more times you have. And would you soften your heart and just put your hand up this morning, preacher, would you pray for me? No need to be embarrassed here. I'm not going to point you out. Thank you. I see one hand going up, two hands going up, three hands going up. Thank you very much. Who else would put their hands up this morning? This is just before you and God saying, God, I'm not walking away this morning. I'm softening my heart. I'm moving towards you. Who else would put their hands up? Three have raised their hands. Don't be ashamed. Don't be bashful during this time. This is important. For those who have raised their hands, and maybe for some who are just lacking the courage to do so, if your heart is ready and ripe to receive Christ this morning, I'm going to lead you in a prayer. Right now, I want you to make that commitment in your heart that this day forward, you no longer are your own, but you belong to God. You just pray this and mean it with all of your heart as you speak directly to God. Father, I believe that Jesus died on the cross for my sin. I confess that I am a sinner and my sin cost Christ everything. But he died in my place. And then he rose again, conquering sin and death. And I believe that in my heart, I believe that. And right now, by faith, I receive him into my heart as my Lord and my King. Make me into the person that you want me to be. Right now, I commit my life to you. For you alone, I will live. With no one looking around, did you pray that prayer for the first time this morning? Would you just put your hand up in the air for me to see? Anyone make that commitment fresh this morning? Thank you, sir. Praise God. We rejoice with you. Anyone else? Okay, I'm going to put that conversation on hold. And Christians, I want to speak to you because you know what? You're just as good at this. Have you been harboring a sin in your life? Have you been living in such a way that you know that you're not filled with the Spirit? You know that you're not exalting Christ in a way that God intends you to. But you've hardened your heart to certain things that are happening in your life that have been happening for a long time. Boy, God would love to break that this morning. Again, just by way of acknowledgement, would you slide your hand in the air right now and say, as a sign to God, God, I am I am softening my heart this morning. Instead of resisting you, I'm admitting to you this morning, I've got an issue that we need to overcome together. One hand already going up. Would you just indicate that? Many hands going up. God, I'm softening to you. Many hands, more hands. Oh my, church, there's so many hands going up all over the room. Still going up, still going up. Then church, this is what that means. You can put your hands down. As you indicate physically right now that as your hand goes up, God, I'm softening my heart to something that I've been hardening my heart towards. Now it's your turn to surrender to the Lord's leading in this area. And it won't be easy because this is territory that Satan has staked as his own. But today, you surrender it to the Lord. This is called forsaking sin. Not just confessing it right now as you put your hand up. Yes, Lord, there's a problem, but it is time to forsake it. It's time for the way we live, the thoughts in our minds to change and to be submitted to God's control. And He promises you, church, triumph, victory in Christ as we cling to Him. Father, right now, your church is reaching out to you. They're pressing into you. They're softening their hearts as the Spirit is working. And Father, I pray for the victory. Don't let this one slip away. I don't know what some of these battles are, but I know, Father, that these battles can go so deep and last so long that they nearly snuff our influence for Christ out entirely. So, Father, give us the victory today because there are souls to be won. There is work to be done in this community, and we need these people, Father. And they're surrendering their hearts right now. Father, help them work through the sin and break the chains, soften the hearts, that forgiveness of sins and the filling of the Spirit in a fresh way would happen this morning to your people. Lord, we invite you to do this work in our lives. We soften our hearts before you and invite your Spirit to thrive and to reign in these hearts. Lord, we love you and we thank you for the power of your word and the work of your Spirit. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Church, let's stand to our feet. If the Spirit's striving in your heart this morning, why don't you take one more step now? Why don't you come forward and simply take to a time of prayer, resolving to settle this issue here this morning. If you've confessed Christ as Savior, why don't you make that public this morning? Won't you come? Just put your hand in mine. We want to celebrate with you. This is your time to respond, church. Let's respond.
All who are thirsty.
This is no time to be ashamed. Won't you come?
All who are weary.
God is working in your heart. Won't you come? Don't worry about what others are thinking. If you've given your life to the Lord Jesus Christ this morning, I pray for your boldness, your courage. Won't you come? Make that public this morning. You just come right down this aisle to me. You don't need to say a word. Won't you come?
As deep cries out to
this is your time to respond, church.
Come, Lord Jesus, come.
We're going to sing for just a little while longer. It's not too late. Won't you come?
Come, Lord Jesus.
Soften your hearts, church. Time through, let's sing.
To all who are thirsty, all who are weak, come to the
it's not
fountain.
Too late.
Dip your heart in the streams of life, let the pain and the sorrow be washed away. In the waves of His mercy, as deep rise out.